Hello and welcome to Worlds Apart. After decades of condemnation and planned destruction, chemical weapons seem to be back in use, not only as toxic agents, but increasingly as agents of influence over public opinion. Does the political hype around the use of chemical weapons help the disarmament cause? Well, to discuss that, I'm now joined by Paul Walker, a program director at Green Cross International and one of the world's top experts on chemical weapons. Mr. Walker, thank you very much for your time. Now, the demolition of chemical weapons seems to be a very popular theme with award and prize givers recently. The Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons has just been awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. You're about to receive the so-called Alternative Nobel Prize. But I wonder if it isn't too early to celebrate, because sure, more than 60% of the world's declared chemical weapons have been destroyed, but the remaining stockpiles arguably represent the biggest challenge.
I think that's a very good question. I think, first of all, I feel very honored to receive the Right Livelihood Award, so-called Alternative Nobel Prize, and I'm very pleased that the OPCW has received the Nobel Peace Prize. Now, whether this is too early, I would say no. It's certainly too early for Syria. I mean, we still have to wait and see how the Syrian declaration goes, whether the process of inventorying and destruction goes well, and that will take probably another year or so. But I think the Nobel Peace Prize and the prize, so the Alternative Nobel awarded to me, are really recognizing well over two decades of work that many of us, particularly the OPCW and their many, many inspectors that are now in Syria, have done for a long, long time. I mean, we've been very actively pursuing building a world free of chemical weapons, and over 55,000 metric tons have now been destroyed globally in six countries. So the peace prizes, the Nobels, are really not a function of Syria.
As far as I understand, in those 20 years that you just mentioned, you personally have been involved in the elimination of chemical arsenals in six countries. And I understand that this is a very sophisticated, a very complex technical and technological process. I wonder how vulnerable it is to politics, in your view.
Well, I mean, I think the process of chemical weapons destruction, which began really in the 1980s, when the Soviet Union and the United States began bilaterally talking about destroying their stockpiles, was relatively unknown. It became much more of a political process really in the 1990s when the Chemical Weapons Convention was open for signature, but not within the multilateral community so much. It was really within Russia and the United States between federal, regional and local authorities.
I think the Syrian issue is probably the best example of how intertwined politics and the technological process can be. I wonder whether you were surprised by the speed of action on the Syrian case. Were you surprised how quickly the events unfolded in Syria?
We have been. I mean, we've all, those of us in the chemical weapons destruction field have worked for years in getting countries to join the Chemical Weapons Convention. When the treaty was open for signature in 1993, we had about 100, 125 countries join, including Russia and the United States, the two big possessor states of chemical stockpiles. But the Syrian question, as well as Israel, Egypt, and then, of course, maybe the toughest country will be North Korea. There's still six countries outstanding. We didn't expect Syria to come in when it did, but I do think this horrible, you know, inhumane civil war, which has dragged on for 2.5 years, was really ratcheted up in public attention and politics when there were 1,400 people killed on August 21st with a chemical attack just
still,
east of Damascus.
We unfortunately don't know who actually was behind that attack. Neither the UN inspectors nor any other observers could ascertain that for sure, even though obviously different countries, different capitals have different opinions. But since you already mentioned Russia and the United States, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think both of these countries have missed the deadlines that the OPCW set out for them. Now, Syria cannot afford to do that, and Syria is now placed under a very tight deadline. It has to demolish its chemical weapons till mid next year, and if it fails to comply with that deadline, there is a threat of force on the table. I wonder if on the technical side there is any danger of rushing ahead with the disarmament process without having all that preparation done beforehand.
Well, I agree that we really don't want to rush too fast and endanger anybody. I mean, the main purpose of all these stockpile destructions, whether it's Russia, whether it's the United States, whether it's India, South Korea, Albania, has been to protect the environment and public health. And so you don't want to do anything that will endanger public health and the environment, particularly workers. I still think the Syrian stockpile can be destroyed by the middle of next year, largely due to the type of chemicals. Most of the chemicals, if not all, are really precursor chemicals. There's very little, if any, chemical agents that are weaponized, in other words, in a rocket or in an artillery shell, combined with energetics and rocket propellant, which makes it very difficult to access and destroy. So I'm actually one of the optimists that, in fact, if the countries, primarily Russia and the United States and other industrialized countries, contribute the funding and the technology and the technical know-how to Syria, to get this done, it can certainly be done by next year, but we don't really know yet the full extent of the stockpile.
But I think that's the most crucial point here, mm-hmm. That we don't know the extent of the stockpiles. And if we are to believe the U.S. Secretary of State, right, John Kerry, Syria possesses roughly 1,000 tons of chemical agents. Now, looking at right. the countries who used to have similarly sized stockpiles, like, for example, India or South Korea, it took them 3 to 4 years to actually complete that process. And, you know, the demolition process only began after a fairly lengthy period of, you know, building those plants that would be dealing with the chemicals and so on. So I guess what I'm asking you here is whether rushing full speed with chemical disarmament, again, without much preparation, could present a danger for the environment, for the public health, because, as you said, the OPCW goal is ultimately not just to get rid of chemical weapons, but to get rid of them in a sustainable and responsible way.
I agree, but I would say, to respond to you directly, that we know pretty much what the stockpile now consists of. It's not fully public knowledge, but it's about 1,000 tons. It's primarily 30% of blister agents like mustard, and it's primarily 70% nerve agents like sarin. But most of that is in precursor chemicals. Now, these are dual-use chemicals. That's unlike the stockpiles in India and South Korea, and also unlike the stockpile in Albania. Albania had a much smaller stockpile, but destroyed its stockpile in a mobile incinerator in about 4 months, 4 to 5 months. If we know that these are precursor chemicals, and I think we'll know that in the next couple of weeks, if we know that we can move those chemicals over to one centralized site and provide good security on that, and given the fact that the OPCW and a number of the countries involved, namely Russia and the United States and Europeans and Japan, are moving already to provide technology, explosive destruction systems, neutralization systems, and the like, maybe a small incinerator, the job can be done. It will be a challenge, I agree, it's very ambitious. It will need a lot of money. You know, the OPCW has no funds to do this, and it will need additional inspectors as well. The OPCW has insufficient inspectors right now. But I think all of that is doable.
Mr. Walker, you just mentioned the possibility of providing incinerators for Syria. And I think in the United States, incineration right. as a method of destruction is highly contested. And there are a lot of experts who believe that as a method, this is not very environmentally sound. But what I would like to ask you is something different. Since politics is so much involved in the issue of chemical weapons in Syria, do you think the OPCW as an organization is strong enough to defend the process that it just embarked upon in Syria, and that it can ensure that this process is indeed completed in a responsible way, even if it means that deadlines are extended?
Well, I think deadlines are important. And obviously, as you mentioned previously, every single declared possessor state of the Chemical Weapons Convention has missed their deadlines to date. The Russians have missed theirs, the Americans have missed theirs, the Albanians missed theirs by 2 months. So deadlines are important in this particular case because of the civil war and the urgency that none of these weapons be lost or diverted or stolen by rebel forces or anyone else in the region, it's very important, I think, that we try to adhere to the framework agreement, which means by somewhere in the middle of next summer, 2014, the destruction take place. I think there are a number of issues that really won't threaten a military strike. If indeed, though, we find that President Assad is lying or cheating, and I'm doubtful that he'll do that because his life is really on the line and it's probably the life of the whole regime. If we were to find that, then of course, then I think a military strike could take place.
But Mr. Walker, it's not only about President Assad and the possibility of him lying, because if we look at the history of the OPCW and its engagements in the past with the United States, there is a history of, let's say, intimidation or manipulation, whatever you call it, because we know that the previous administration, for example, George W. Bush's administration, used all means possible to denounce the first general director of the organization and made everything possible to prevent Iraq under the Saddam Hussein regime from joining the treaty, and the main reason for that was to, you know, have this pretext of going to war in Iraq. At least that's what many experts in the United States believe. So why do you think this new administration in the White House would refrain from using politics to stand in the way of disarmament?
Well, I disagree with that. I mean, I think I personally believe the ouster of Jose Bostani, the first director general of the OPCW in 2002, primarily on the initiative of the United States, was a mistake.
But absolutely, but the United States also went to war with Iraq, and it didn't help the disarmament
cause
at all.
But that had very little to do with the OPCW.
But it had a lot to do with weapons of mass
destruction. The OPCW today is a very strong organization. It did. And the United States, the Bush administration at that point, alleged that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction, which he did not. And many of us spoke out, myself included, publicly saying there are not weapons of mass destruction. They were all destroyed in the 91 Gulf War. He did have weapons of mass destruction in the 1980s, and they were destroyed in 91, and then all further destroyed and sealed up by the United Nations inspection commissions back in the 1990s. But your question of whether the OPCW is capable of doing this destruction, absolutely. First of all, it's not the OPCW that does the destruction. It's the responsibility of the state party. So it's the responsibility of Syria. But Syria is a poor country. It needs financial support and it needs technical support from the countries that have long experience doing this now: Russia, the United States, Japan, China, and many of the European countries, which have worked to clean up the legacy of World War I and World War II for decades. So we all need to pitch in, and the OPCW is only as strong as the member states. And so what I've said many times is we need at this point to support the OPCW and the United Nations. We need to get on with the inventorying, complete the declaration, which I gather is very good, from Syria, and in fact do whatever we can. This in the short time period will cost probably, I think, $100 or $200 million or more. And Syria doesn't have that money.
Mr. Walker, we have to take a short break now, but when we come back, with over 60% of the world's declared chemical weapons already destroyed, why would some experts claim that the danger posed by chemical weapons is greater than ever? That's coming up in a few moments on Worlds Apart.
In his secret laboratory, Tim Kirby was able to build the world's most sophisticated robot, which unfortunately doesn't give a darn about anything. Tim's mission? To teach his creation why it should care about humans and world events. This is Why You Should Care. Watch only on RT.com.
He turned his lover into an Amazon.
That had been my dream for so long.
But he couldn't hold on to her.
There is such a thing as outgrowing your teacher.
Now she runs her own Amazon factory, where they throw down a challenge to men. There's no alcohol or smoking, and even coffee is forbidden. They worship the earth, fire, and water, and learn martial arts. Will he ever be able to win her back? Man versus Woman on RT.
You know, it takes all the running you can do to keep in the same place, said the Red Queen to Alice. It takes all the printing you can do to keep in the same place, said the banksters to Bernanke. It takes all the working you can do to keep in the same place, said the neo-feudal facts to the chumps who have to work for a living. But I say, not only does it take all the running, printing, and working, but it also takes all the bombing, stealing, and defrauding, spying, lying, and dying, shaking, baking, and taking to stay in the same frickin' place.
Right from the scene. First-rate news and eye-gripping pictures. On our reporters' Twitter and Instagram. To be in the know, follow us online.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart, where we are discussing how to read the planet of chemical weapons with one of the world's top experts on the subject, Paul Walker. Mr. Walker, just before the break, we were talking about whether or not the OPCW is independent and strong enough of an organization to be free from influence of certain powers. And I know that you try to steer clear of politics, but I have to ask you this question as somebody who invested so many years of your life to this very important subject. Now, when we discuss the Syrian chemical weapons issue, it's very difficult to separate the technical goal of disarmament from the political implications. And the feeling here in Moscow, at least, is that the United States may have a direct conflict of between these two goals. On one hand, they may want Assad to do away with its chemical weapons, but on the other hand, politically, they are not so excited about it, fearing that it would legitimize his power, that it may prolong his stay in the government. We all know how high the political stakes are, but I wonder, how strong do you think is the will, especially in Washington, to get rid of those weapons safely and responsibly, and whether that will is strong enough to prevail over other considerations, including political considerations?
Yeah, I think the will is very strong here in the United States. I think it's very strong, obviously, in Russia. And I think it's very strong amongst all the states' parties I've spoken with at the OPCW. We're all interested in building a world that's really completely free of chemical weapons and continuing to guarantee that, in fact, they'll never return or reemerge. And so it's in everyone's interest. I think it's a win-win-win, as we say, for everybody, Syria, the United States, Russia, and other states' parties, to, in fact, safely, securely, and carefully destroy serious chemical weapons. But we still have, you know, six countries outstanding from the treaty regime. So that's an ongoing challenge.
Mm-hmm. Now, in Syria, we had numerous allegations of false flag attacks with gruesome outcomes and involving both conventional and chemical weapons. And obviously, those allegations against various sides are yet to be confirmed. But if that phenomenon of committing egregious crimes to frame your enemy is indeed there, if it's indeed confirmed, wouldn't that represent a new chapter in the history of chemical weapons, using them not just as weapons, but as a means of political persuasion?
Well, I think, you know, chemical weapons are generally believed, when compared to biological weapons and nuclear weapons, as, in fact, the most likely weapon of sort of indiscriminate, inhumane, massive destruction that terrorist groups would use. So everyone is worried about chemical agents like we saw used in Tokyo, Japan in 1995, and like Saddam Hussein used in Halabja in 1988. We're all worried about use of chemical agents, and that's why we've been working for decades to rid the world of these. I think Syria coming into the treaty has been a really historic step forward. And I give a lot of credit to both Russia and the United States, and also to President Assad for agreeing to accede to the treaty. But it also means that we have to put pressure on Israel and Egypt in particular. Those two countries have no reason to stay outside the treaty regime. And obviously there's politics around all of this. I mean, mm-hmm. the Middle East politics, the Israeli-Palestinian politics, the Israeli nuclear stockpile, which is linked to chemical and biological options too for the Arab countries, is all part of the politics. So we're very used to being in the midst of some pretty contentious politics. And I think, though, at this point, it's really good news for Syria. It's good news for the Middle East. It's good news for Russian-American relations, too, that they're working together at last in the last few years on something that's really a positive step forward.
But at the same time, when you talk about Syria becoming the member of this treaty, I think what's important to specify is that we are only talking about the so-called Assad regime. We are not talking about the opposition side, which has also believed to have used chemical weapons. And I know that President Assad has used this phrase of sarin being kitchen gas many times, and many people criticized him for that. And I would like to use your technical expertise and ask you this question. How easy it is for non-state actors, for rebel groups to produce those types of chemicals in an artisan way? Is it possible? Would they have the expertise, the availability of precursors, the equipment?
You know, the production of blister and nerve agents is actually not very difficult. There are recipes on the websites, on the web. We know that in the Aum Shinrikyo terrorist group in Japan in the mid-1990s, they produced actually homemade, kind of do-it-yourself sarin agent, very similar to what's being used in Syria today. What is more difficult, and this was shown in Japan in 1995, is the sort of efficient dispersal of it, so that it's such a widespread killing agent. And that's where I think things differ. The Japanese had a very hard time dispersing the agent in any way. They killed, in the big subway attack in 1995, the Japanese killed 12 people. They injured 5,000 people, but that was primarily due to the panic that set in the subway. In this case, in Syria, we've had attack by very sophisticated rockets and artillery shells, and perhaps even spray tanks and bombs as well. And that's very difficult to produce in a small rebel group or a subnational group. I personally don't believe the rebels have used any chemical weapons. I don't believe they've had access to these chemical agents. And I personally believe that the attacks have all come from the President Assad regime. Mm-hmm. But as you say, that's not been completely proven.
But isn't it the case that it's also been reported that Iraqi insurgents are probably the most active in experimenting with all sorts of chemicals, and that they may have inherited some of the expertise from the former Ba'ath regime and some of the former Saddam Hussein generals. So there is this link from a state actor that used to have chemical weapons industrially produced to non-state actors, rebels in Syria, that may have been produced in an artisan way or may have been transferred. Because Syria and Iraq, as you know, share the border. It's a very porous border. And they also share some of the ideology, because some of the groups, they migrate between those two countries.
Yeah, I don't think that's out of the range of possibility at all. I mean, we do know that in Iraq over the years, insurgents actually tried to use chemical agents. They actually put explosives, sort of improvised explosive devices, what we call IEDs, in combination with canisters of tanks of chlorine gas. And that was actually not very effective. We knew that they were using those. They tried to blow up the canisters. But unless you have a fairly sophisticated dispersal device in which you can vaporize these agents, the agents are all liquid in the weapon. They're liquid. And in fact, when you get over a target area or your victims, you have to vaporize it in some fashion. And unless you have a very sophisticated explosive mechanism to do that, it's almost impossible to use it as an effective weapon. In fact, simple explosives actually work much better. So I remain skeptical, actually, that the rebels have used chemical agents at all in this two and a half year old Syrian civil war.
Mm-hmm. Now, you're obviously not a terrorism expert, but given your experience in the area, what would be the primary appeal for any non-state actor or a terror group to try to acquire those weapons? Because as you just said, they're very difficult to procure, they're very difficult to use, their killing power is inferior to conventional weapons. So is it primarily the symbolism of chemical weapons that make them attractive for these groups?
You know, I think any weapon of mass destruction, whether it's nuclear, chemical, biological, or radioactive, is a very good terrorist weapon because it instills literally terror in the civilian population. It's not a very good military weapon, and that's essentially, I think, why the Chemical Weapons Convention has been so successful, and it's essentially why both the Soviets in the 1980s and the Americans in the 1980s agreed unilaterally and reciprocally to give up their chemical weapons. But weapons like this really do instill terrorism in the human population. And so a terrorist group can get a lot more attention, even though it may even kill fewer people, by using such a weapon.
You do seem to believe that it's primarily about the symbolism and the terror power of those weapons. But if it's so, then isn't there a danger that the more world leaders talk publicly about chemical weapons, the more red lines are drawn, the more prizes are given, the bigger is the psychological incentive for these groups to actually get hold of them? Because as you said, terrorism is not about how many people you kill, it's about how many people you scare.
Well, I think you're right. I mean, I think on the one hand, terrorists have stated over and over again, Osama bin Laden when he was alive, and Al-Qaeda and other terrorist groups, Chechen terrorists, have all stated they wanted to get their hands on nuclear, chemical, and biological weapons, or CBRN, including radiological weapons as well. More discussion in the public like this may make it even more desirable to get their hands on that. On the other hand, I think the horror that we've seen with the, particularly the August 21st attack in Syria, really has revolted the human population. I think people in general have felt that these weapons are inhumane, and the whole legal norm in the world is, in fact, to ban these weapons. So I think what that does to all of us is it puts pressure on us to, in fact, make sure that these weapons are not available. And that's why we've worked so hard over the years to destroy them in such a major fashion all throughout the world. We'll continue to work on the remaining, you know, 10, 15,000 metric tons that are still available, and we will continue to work to get the non-state members like Israel and Egypt and North Korea and Angola and South Sudan and Myanmar into the treaty regime, and then we'll continue to work to investigate and inspect all chemical industry around the world for the indefinite future so that these chemicals never reemerge.
And Mr. Walker, I think we also have to make sure that non-state actors, those in Syria, in Iraq, in Africa, that they also don't get hold of chemical weapons. But unfortunately, this is all we have time for. Thank you very much for being on the show. And if you like the program, please join us again. Same place, same time, here on Worlds Apart.